Shesham means the primary thing has to be first. Shesham Padi Prayojagatvat. Because of Satyanarayana Puja that this food is there, and not because of the food that Satyanarayana Puja is there. You know, that is all that is meant to say here. Because of the prana upasana, the japa is there, and not that because of that for the sake of japa, the prana upasana is there. That is the idea here. Therefore, because prana upasana is nitya, is essential, the japa is anitya, non-essential or secondarily essential. Tasyavi prachinatvam kaham. Alright, how do you say that the prana upasana is prachina, meaning it comes first? Vashyakara says, vijnanasya cha nityavat shravanat. That vijnana means the prana upasana, nityavat means essential. See, footnote number 3 and 4, evam vit prayojyatvadidi prana vijnanavada anusthayatvadityatha japasyan. The japa is to be performed by the one who has performed the prana upasana. Japasya prana vijnanavat purusha anusthayatvena vijnanat pragasatvat kadachikatvam. See, japa is to be performed by the one who has performed meditation upon the prana. It is not there before the prana upasana. Therefore, it is kadachit coming. It is something that is now there and not there before. Tadeva chatya tasya anityatvam. Anityatvam and nitya is only in the technical language. Anityatvam, here comes, which comes later. Nitya is that which is there first, you know. Nitya vashramanadi siddha vashramanadityatha. Evam Veda itasya siddha vashrama. Yeah, evam Veda, one who knows this, or one who meditates. So therefore, he is understood that it is there to begin with. So therefore, it is accepted here as essential. No, evam vidyadi sadhyava nityatha. Oh, evam Veda is nitya. That means, so the tense is evam Veda tasya siddha vashranam nadu evam vidyad. May one meditate. One who meditates like this gains the result, and one may one meditate like this. So may one meditate gives a choice, or one who meditates gets this. So one who meditates means this is something that is done all the time. So one who knows this, or one who meditates gets the result, meaning that this kind of prana upasana is going on all along, I guess, you know, that is the idea of so nityava shravanam. Well, say Anandagiri in the last, yayavam vidvan paunamasim yajate itivad yayavam veda iti vijnanam sutam. Yayavam vidvan paunamasim yajate. So yayavam vidvan meaning one who has meditated in this manner, that is the person who performs the paunamasa yaga. So when you say that this person performs the paunamasa yaga, meaning evam vidvan, one who has meditated in this manner or perform upasana, performs paunamasa yaga. So that means that meditation is already established, then alone the paunamasa yaga comes. Similarly, evam veda, one who has meditated thus performs the japa. Nahi prayajadi paunamasi prayojakam tasyaha eva tat prayojakatvat. So paunamasi there is primary and the prayaja is secondary, you know, and similarly here, in short, this meditation is primary and japa. Taha pranavit prayojyo japa na vijnana prayojaka. In short, japa is to be performed by the one who has performed the upasana on prana and not the other way around. Tasya sva prayojakatvena prageva siddhe avashyakatvad ityartha. Tasya sva prayojakatvena prageva siddhe avashyakatvad ityartha. Since that prana upasana is prageva siddha, meaning it is already something that has been performed, therefore it is out. So when you say naturally that, evam vidvan yajate, one who meditates like this, he performs his yaga, he does his japa, meaning that naturally meditation has already taken place. So in short, when you say that, so one who has passed the MSc will get the admission here in PhD, meaning that MSc passing has already been done. Otherwise, the entrance to PhD cannot be. So entrance to PhD calls for having cleared this MSc examination. So it is taken for, so Siddhavat is taken for granted that person has passed MSc for qualifying for the entrance to PhD. So it is taken for granted that One has performed the pranopasana for qualifying for that japa. In that sense it is said siddhavat. When he accepted that is already there, then alone this japa can be performed. Okay, now on page 76. Phalavatvacha pranavijnanam svatantram vidhitsitam iti aha. Phalavatvacha, that upasana of the prana, so this is another way. So what is phalavat? What is it that has an immediate result or that has a benefit? So that which is beneficial must be the primary thing. So phalavatvacha says footnote number 11. Kincha iha prakarane taddhaitadidi vakyat utkrushta phalavishishtam pranavijnanam yadashrutam tadha phalavatvadavi tadvishyam vijnanam vidhadamishtamidi dvayahityadi vakyam tat parameva na vidhyandar paramityaha phalavatvachedi. Says footnote 11. Kincha iha prakarane, in this particular discussion, taddhaitadidi vakyat taddhaitad lokajit eva. So, one who meditates upon the prana conquers the worlds. Iti vakya. So, that statement, the phala is there, that one who meditates upon the prana thus conquers the different worlds. Utkrishta phala visishtam prana vijnanam. So, therefore, the meditation on the prana has this very exalted result in terms of conquering all the worlds. Tataha phala vatvad api tad vishayam vijnanam. Therefore, this is yet another reason that this meditation it brings about an exalted result, therefore also that must be the primary meditation. Vijnanam vidhatam ishtam, and therefore that must be alone the intention of the Shruti to enjoin. Vidhatam ishtam, that must be what is desired by the Shruti to enjoin, because this vijnanam gives you so much result. So in between, japa also gives you some result, and the Gita also, everything gives some results, all right. That, as we said, Satyanarayana Puja means what result comes? I don't know. You get your children, all sorts of things you can get. In between, Varuna Puja gives a little result and Ganesha Puja, some other result. Each one of them has some result. But the most exalted result is of this Satyanarayana Puja. And therefore, we accept that, we conclude that that must be what is meant to be primarily enjoined and not the other things, even though other things also may have result, but lower results. And this one has the most exalted result. Therefore, prana upasana has the most exalted result, so that must be the one that is sought to be enjoined by the Shruti. Iti dvayaha ityada vakyam tat parameva. Therefore, this passage is tat param, meaning prana upasana param, na vidhyandara param. Even if the japa vidhi etc. is there, this is not meant for other vidhi, it is meant for the prana upasana vidhi. So it is said, phalavatvacha. Prana-vijnanam svatantram vidhichatam. Svatantram idhi na kasyati sheshabhutam. That the prana-upasana stands on its own and is not meant to serve the purpose of something else. It's other thing which serves the purpose of prana-upasana. That is the idea here. So Vashyakara says, taddha etata lokajideva iti chashrutehe. This is the very last mantra. In the verse mantra 28, this is a result, that one conquers the worlds. Says footnote number 1, taddha ityadi hashabdatra kaivalyam brute. Taddha kaivalyam. Kaivalyam means merely prana upasana without the accompaniment of any other thing. Sarvanamani cha upasanam tat etat. There are the two sarvanamas, the pronouns, both of them refer to upasana only and not karma or japa or something like that. What is tat and etat? So that which is such, that which is such, one who meditates upon that, he or that who is such conquers the world. So that refers to whom? Refers to the upasana, tat and etat. Tatha cha kevalam karma asahakritam pranopasanam sutratmatva sadhanam. Lokam, lokajit means what? One who conquers all the worlds means one who is on the top of the world, meaning one who becomes Hiranyagarbha. So ultimately the result of this prana upasana is Hiranyagarbha or Sutratmatvam. Tathacha kevalam prana upasanam Sutratmatva sadhanam. So prana upasana alone is the means for attainment of state of Hiranyagarbha without the accompaniment of any ritual. This is what is intended to be said here. तद्धेतत लोकजिदेव इति च श्रुते हैं प्राणोपासते हैं विवक्षतत्वे हेतुंतरमाह दिनभाष्यकर tells us another reason why the upasana is प्राणोपासना says further प्राणस्य वागादीनांच शुद्धि अशुद्धि वचनात् नहि अनुपास्यत्वे प्राणस्य शुद्धिवचनम् वागादीनांच सह उपन्यस्तानां अशुद्धिवचनम् वागादिनिन्दया मुख्यप्राणस्तुतिश्च अभिप्रेता उपपद्यते Pranasya vagadinancha shuddhi ashuddhi vachana. See, prana is described here as shuddha and other vag, indriya, etc. described as ashuddha. Shuddhi ashuddhi vachana. See, his footnote number 3. Pranasya shuddhi ashuddhischa vagadinamidi uktivashat asmin prakarane pranopasthi abhipreta. So here we are told the prana alone was pure and therefore could not be corrupted by the asuras. The other indriyas were not pure, therefore they could be corrupted by the asuras, by that. So there is a ninda of the other vagadi indriyas and there is a stuti of the prana. That also shows that the prana is the one who is the object of meditation and not the other ones. That also makes it very clear that it is mukhya prana who is the object of meditation, who is enjoined here as the object of meditation and not the vaga, not the indriyas, etc. Anyasatta shuddhyadi vachanam anarthakam syat. In spite of prana being shuddha and vagadi being ashuddha, still we are told that meditate upon vagadi, suppose, you know. Then what's the purpose of telling me that, you know? So having told us, you know, how wonderful it is, you know, to, I don't know, go to Bombay, whatever it is, you know. And then he says, but you go to Baroda, you know. So, but why do you tell me all this then? Doesn't make sense. So whenever you say Baroda is such a miserable place and Bombay is such a wonderful place and this, that, and after concluding that half of our talk, you say, you go to Baroda. Then you wonder, you know, then why did you do this? The purpose of, since they wanted to encourage me to go to Bombay for whatever reason and discourage me from going to Baroda, let us say. This is just an example, you know, illustration. Why should these things come to, I don't know, but anyway. And then naturally therefore the intention is to enjoin or to encourage this fellow to go to Bombay. Therefore it cannot be that in spite of having praised Bombay that no, that is not what I meant, I only meant Baroda, even though I did this. It cannot be. Similarly when there is Vagadi Ninda is here and the Prana Stuti is there, naturally the intention is to present prana as the object of meditation and not present vagadi. Otherwise, whatever you want to present as object of meditation as primary thing, you always present it first. But in the principal way, you know, other things are okay. So everything always takes place like that. All in the politics also, who gets what seat and how they are introduced and when they talk and anywhere. That's why, you know, who counts here and who does not count, where to pay attention, where not to. Whose statements are important, whose statements are not. Otherwise you keep on listening to 55 people, you cannot. You have to spot out what is important here. Other things you need not worry about. Everywhere in the world it is like this. When you will visit somebody's house, you always in your mind judge, oh, now who is important here? And therefore, you go to a business place, you go to office, you go anywhere. You don't have all the time to deal with everybody, you know. And therefore, you have to in your own mind determine who is important, who counts. So you observe, you find, you know, who follows whom and then, you know, whose words count, whose words don't. When you visit a home also, it's very important. Who is important in this house? So who we should deal with? That's important. Otherwise you get thrown out of the house. You know, the thing is, if you want to be there, you should know whose upasana or whose friendship is to be cultivated. Not that you have to be enemy to other one, but whose friendship is more important. Anyway, similarly also here, the prana upasana is done and vaga, the ninda is done. Naturally, Shruti intends to present prana as the primary object of meditation and not vagadi. Pranasya vagadinam cha shuddhi ashuddhi vachanat. So how many things we are told here? How to study this? How to read? How to communicate? How to understand? You see, all of this will learn from these kind of, although these discussions may appear technical, they are very practical. They are very practical because day in everyday life also, these things play a role, you know. So pranasya vagadinam cha shuddhi ashuddhi vachanat. Meaning pranasya shuddhi vachanam, vagadinam ashuddhi vachanam. Yaddhistuyate tad vidhiyate iti nyayam ashritya. That which is praised is always intended to be enjoined. So says, nahi anupasyatve pranasya shuddhi vachanam. If prana was not an upasana visaya, then there was no point in presenting it in such a manner. Vagadinam cha saha upanyastanam ashuddhi vachanam. This is footnote number 4. It's clear, but anyway, he still gives a long explanation. Nityadi upadyadi ityantasya bhashyasya ayamartaha vagadinam asuddhatvena ninda pranasya suddhatvena stutihi iti arthavadat lingat pranopasane vidhi kalpyadeti. So, whoever is prana is praised and the vagadina are, you know, they are censured. And so, pranopasane vidhi kalpade. Arthavada lingakam. This is an arthavada. Stuti also is arthavada. Ninda also is there. Stuti is there. Vidhi is there. Ninda is there. Nisheda is there. Arthavada lingakam vidhi kalpanam anyatravi prasiddhamidhi vaktum abhipreta idi uktan. And this is the method that is employed everywhere. So, abhipreta bhashyakara said. So, vagadinam cha saha upanyastanam ashuddhi vachanam vagadindaya mukhya prana stutisya abhipreta upadyate. And so that stuti of the mukhya prana and ninda of the vagadi seems to convey that the prana is the mukhya upasthi vishaya here. Okay. Then Sri Ranamagiri, mukti mokshanantaram vagadinam yad agnyaditvam phalam तद्ध्यात्म परिच्छेदम हित्वा उपासितुः आदिदैविक प्राणस्वरूपा आपत्तेः उपपद्यते तस्मात् विदित्सिता एवत्र प्राणोपास्ति इत्यर्थः. ओके, सो दैट इज मृत्युम सेज भाष्यकार. ओ इतस्य प्राणोपास्ति अत्र विदित्सिता इति इज अनदर रीजन आल्सो व्हाई वी से दैट द प्राण उपासना इज व्हाट इज एंजॉइंड. आई थॉट आई स्किप अ कपल ऑफ लाइंस बट एनीवे Bhashyakara. Mrityum atikranto dipyate ityadi phalavachanam cha pranasvarupa apatterhi phalam tada yadvagadinam ajnyadi bhavaha. Okay, so mrityum atikram. We read yesterday how all this, see, all the organs such as vag and all of these organs who were corrupted by the asuras, and therefore by prana upasana what happened is that the prana actually took their papa. So mrityu of the nature of papa the prana took and took him to the beyond the end, you know, at the end of the directions. Therefore it was said nowhere, nobody should go there. So there are certain places in India or in the world where you should not go. Ramcharitmanas will refer to that, you know. Certain places are there where you should not go because that is where all the papa is deposited. And therefore, one should remain only where the papa is not. So where the Trishanku, etc. and all these other fellows were there, you know. So I think Ramcharitmanas, those commentators have identified those places. And Bihar or some place like that, you know, where you should not go because that is where this was all deposited, I don't know. But anyway, The idea was, as prana release this vaga, this speech, you know, the organ speech, etc., or these devatas from papa, and therefore they started shining, they became their devatas again. Therefore the organ of speech became Agni. So mrityam adikranto deepyate. When this devata vivag, when he was freed from the mrityu, then deepyate, he started shining as Agni or the fire. So all these, that's what it's said here, that all these fellows who had become adhyatma, meaning individual, limited ones, all of them were able to shed their limitation and attain the state of adhidaivata. All of them attained the state of devata on account of the upasana of prana. So prana upasana results into the attainment of the state of devatva up to Hiranyagarbha. Therefore, that has the exalted result. So that is the phalavachanam. Phalavachanam prasya anupasyatve na upadyate sambandha. If this, see, the upasana of prana gives rise to such exalted result, therefore it doesn't make sense that then prana is not the object of meditation, he must be. Uttameva vyakti prana swarupa apattehe hi phalam tad yad vagadinam agnyadi bhavah. Now read Anandagiri, mrityu mokshananantaram vagadinam yad agnyadityam yajnyadityam. So when the vagadi devatas were released from the mrityu mokshananantaram, then the vagadi all attained that, like vag became agni, and then the shrotram became the dig, the manaha became chandramaha, all of them became the respective devatas, and all of them started shining. Chakshu became surya and whatever. Yet agnyadityam phalam tat adhyatma parichedam hitva, meaning that they became free from the limitation of the individual upadhi. Upasituhu adhidaivika prana swarupa apattehe upadyate, meaning that all these upasakas, the prana, then vag etc. became the upasaka of the prana, and they attained the state of the devata, and thus anybody who performs upasana of the prana will be able to overcome his sense of individuality, meaning embodiment in one body, and attain the state of the devata up to Hiranyagarbha. So this most exalted result is for the upasana of the prana. Therefore we say also that that must be the primary object of upasana. Vag etc., when they perform the upasana upon the prana, then they attain the state of agni etc. So upasaka can, see, the story tells us that the sense organs such as vag etc., when they perform the upasana upon the prana, then they attain the state of devata. It also says that when one upasaka does upasana upon the prana, he can attain the state of Hiranyagarbha. So thus in both ways the result has been stated here. एवं प्राण उपास्ते विदित्चित्तत्वात् विधि विशेषः द्वयः इत्यादि भावः. Therefore this passage is meant for the prana upasana. तस्मात् विदित्चिता एव अत्र प्राण उपास्ते इत्यर्थः. Therefore by all these arguments it is established that it is prana upasana which is the main theme of this chapter. So of this chapter or the Brahmana of the 28 verses, 28 Kandikas, let us say, the main theme is to enjoy the upasana upon the prana. First of all, Vashyakara analyzed, is it meant for enjoining the japa? We said, no, it is not meant for enjoining japa, because the japa is enjoined for the one who performs the upasana upon the prana, and therefore the prana upasana is main. Japa repetition is secondary. Secondly, also it was said that the prana upasana is something that has to be performed first, so it is nitya. The japa is comes later, therefore it is anitya. Therefore also the prana upasana is primary. Also then the shuddhi and asuddhi, the vagadi etc. are not the object of upasana, prana is object of upasana. And the result of the prana upasana also is attainment of up to the state of Hiranyagarbha. Because of all these reasons we say, and also there was another little argument there, from the Udgaya, is this whole section meant to serve the purpose of that Udgita upasana, Udgita chanting, Udgita karma? He says no, Udgita karma is a subject matter of karma kanda. Here the subject matter is prana upasana, and therefore upasana is a subject matter here. So by all these arguments, Bhashyakara showed that the subject matter of this brahmana is prana upasana. And how the Upanishad does is it? By ninda of the vagadi, by the stuti of the prana, by telling us the result of what one attains as a result of upasana of the prana. And how this upasana can be combined with the karma or the ritual of the nature of chanting that japa, doing that japa, that then the result it would be even more exalted, that abhyaroha, meaning one becomes free from the one's human, you know, aspect, limitation as a human being, and attains the state of devata. So all of that is meant for presenting prana as upasya vishaya. The two things are said. Number one, that is topic, the main topic of this section is to enjoin the upasana upon the prana. And secondly, the one who is the object of meditation is prana and not anybody else. Not the vagadi, etc., but the prana is the upasya vishaya, and the prana upasya is the main topic here of this brahmana. This is what is established in the arguments so far. Having established that, now it is necessary to establish how the prana is to be meditated upon. That also, what is the nature of this prana? And prana endowed with which attributes is to be meditated upon? That also is to be established. And that is what Bhashyakara wants to establish next. Uktanyayana pranupastim upetya pranadevatanam suddhyadigunavatim akshipati bhavatu iti. Now Bhashyakara wants to show that prana is possessed of the qualities of being pure and exalted and uncorrupted, and prana such as that is to be meditated upon. So the Pura Bhakshi wants to say that even though the Upanishad seems to say that prana is possessed of the purity, etc., it is not meant in a primary sense, it is meant in secondary sense. That's how, that's an argument. That even though Upanishad says that prana is Shuddha, it is not meant that way. It is just to present, since prana is upasya vishaya, therefore, by the way the stuti of the prana is done, it is prana stuti and not a fact about prana. So there also we have to sift the facts from the chaff, again in every communication. What is stuti? You present a little child, you know, as a, you know, Swamiji, Anandu, Baddhu, Javada, everything he knows and stuff like that, and that's all, you know. The idea is to encourage that fellow to chant Shuklam, Bharadaram, Vishnu, that's all, nothing more than that. So now what will you do? The other day you did this. So 15 minutes it takes to invoke this fellow to chant something, you know. And so you keep on saying all kinds of things about how wonderful he is, you know. We know that all this is meant for merely encouraging this fellow to chant, nothing more than that. So we'll dismiss all those other details. Or if you pay attention to every detail, you can't remember those things, you know, and you'll miss the main thing. So here also, when the prana is placed like that, is it really meant that way or not meant that way? You must, so that is also, that needs to be clarified. Somebody says that, that's how the Pura Paksha begins, that the prana is presented as a big deal, you know, it's a, that's not meant actually. So uktanyayana pranupasthi upetya. By this reasoning, it has been shown that the section is devoted to enjoining the meditation on the prana. Prana devatam shuddhyadi gunavatim. Then, that the Upanishad says that the prana is possessed, the devata, prana devata is possessed of such qualities as being pure, etc. That is not meant in a primary sense. It is just a little praise and not a fact. So whether something is a fact or something is said by the way, just because you don't say a fact doesn't mean that you are lying. This is another problem with American children, you know, or Indian children brought up in America. They don't understand this. So Indians are brought up in this tradition. And therefore we say things for which the purpose is arthavada, you say, the purpose is different. And so it requires a little subtle understanding on the part of the listener to understand that even though he is praising this or saying this, he means something else. And when you don't have that subtlety, then when you take things literally, then what happens? You think that, Mom, you are lying. In front of everybody, they will say, Mom, you are lying. Dad, this is not right. You know, so that fellow is, you know, he is really so stunned when he listens to a child. He is making a certain point. This fellow takes everything literally, you know, this little one. That's how he is used to, that's what he thinks is truth. So what is truth in what situation needs to be also understood. And he says, this is, you are lying. But no, I am not lying. I say it has a purpose to be served, and from that standpoint it makes sense, otherwise it would not. So sometimes we are so fanatic or so insensitive, I should not say, or I mean we are so, I don't know what, but not being able to see through, that we get so stick to the words sometimes, to the outer structure of the words, that sometimes we miss the inner spirit, and therefore we accuse people or we misunderstand people as being something else inside and something else outside. And this I find very commonly there. These Indian parents have been brought up here, have a certain way of communicating. We don't always directly say things, we say things indirectly, more than directly. While in the Western society, things are always said directly. Not the politicians, but people in general. So they are generally direct in the sense that having something inside and then something else outside and trying to go roundabout way to say things, because perhaps we feel that certain things should not be said openly or certain things should not be mentioned directly. Paroksha priyaya vahideva, certain things are always said indirectly. So saying indirectly has been ingrained in our structure, in our culture, in our blood. And there were a lot of things like even wife would not talk directly to husband, you know, in the olden days. Or husband also would not talk directly. So that father will tell the son, did you hear, you know, something, Sambhu? Even though father is talking to son, it is man that is talking to his wife, you know. It's not the son who replies, it's she who replies. This fellow doesn't know what is going on. Why is father talking to him? But this kind of paroksha or indirect communication is very common with us. Because we have certain ideas of what we call maryada, or certain ideas about certain dignity, certain sanctity and what not. Certain reverence is there, certain sanctities are there, certain maryadas or limits are there. So many things are there in our culture. It's a very sophisticated culture. And therefore, we understand the human mind so well and what the human being cherishes, etc. We value it so much that we take all those things into account in communication. And those fellows are totally wrong. Therefore, they don't know these things. So everybody is the same. Grandfather also is Tom and father also is Tom and everybody is the same, you know. And therefore, there is no reverence. Everybody is talking, you know, you address everybody by the name. So everybody is equal. We think that by addressing name means by being equal. We can't accept that. You cannot address your father with name. There they will do it. Or grandfather also will be addressed by name often. So elders are also addressed by name. Even a manager or a director also will address by name. Sir, etc. is not there. Whether, now that may have some advantages, you know. But the idea that there should be some reverence, there should be some maryada, that there is someone who is elder or someone who is, you know, more respectable, that in the presence of the people who are more respectable than us, that we should conduct ourselves in a certain manner, there is no such thing. Everybody behaves in every way in front of everybody, you know. So here, the husband and wife would not talk for the whole day because people are present, you know. When do they get chance to even talk to each other? Perhaps at night or when they are out someplace or what it is. Because you cannot talk to each other in presence of the elders. I am not saying whether it is right, wrong or indifferent. All I am saying is, it is idea of the maryada, you know. Maybe these things have to change as the time goes along. I am not recommending this, but I am just pointing out that how this idea of maryada is there in us. And how that always plays a very important part in our behavior, in our communication, in our talk. When this is not there, everything becomes raw. So our few people who are parents, and these their children who are Americans. Although their skin is brown, but the fellows are Americans, Westerners. There is a tremendous gap, not of generation, but of culture. So these people who are accustomed to communicating in a certain way, talking in a certain way, are just stunned when their children address them like this. You know, they feel insulted. So all Indian parents feel insulted, hurt by their own children, because they have grown to respect their parents. And even if they don't necessarily agree with their parents, at least out of the respect, they do what they are told to do. Because giving respect and making them happy is more important than whether it is right or wrong, or whether it is necessarily beneficial to me. It is not always the calculation or criterion, but that he is happy. That's more important to us than perhaps my happiness also. Not so in the West. I do something only if it is convenient to me. And therefore, they don't care whether the father will be hurt or not. They directly say things. Now, this goes by in the name of simplicity and straightforwardness. In fact, very often it is insensitivity, you know. So very often the so-called Western, I am a Westerner, I am oriented West, that means you are insensitive in certain ways, that's what it means. Because this is very sophisticated Indian culture, you know, and all of these are ingrained in us. And when this is not understood, I mean, this can be very often misunderstood, you know. And of course there are disadvantages of this also, that everybody can exploit the system. And so disadvantages can also be there, but I am pointing out how our method of communication in the scriptures is. And therefore we have to ascertain whether when he says a given thing, it is meant in a primary sense or not. Whether he says this to please that person, or he says because it is a fact. Or he says that in order to promote that person, or is it really a fact? And therefore that also needs to be understood why. Because when you perform meditation on the prana, then the prana is pure or sacred. If it is not a fact, then in your meditation that will not appear. If it is a fact, then you will meditate upon prana such as that. So was Lord Krishna there or not? What does it mean? It matters for those who are worshipping Lord Krishna, who are meditating upon him, that whether he was born in Vrindavan is important. So when the devotees go there, to them, every grain of sand in Vrindavan is something which is very sacred, which they place it on their head. And so we don't believe in historical gods and stuff like that, you know, that's okay. But it is very important, because there is an emotional being also. And so, sometimes whether Lord Krishna did given things or not, are these all to be dismissed as leelas and then nothing more than that, or are they facts? If the leelas, then you meditate upon Lord Krishna, where Krishna means what? Krushi bhuvachaka shabdaha, and therefore that Krishna means sadanandaha, and so you dismiss this form altogether. Or the form also was there. It's all very important. Vedanta, what is it? My form, naam, rupta, theek hai. What is the essence? All right. But the essence also is there. But essence is through name and form. So whether names and forms have relevance or not, how much relevance, all of these have to be discussed at great length before you meditate. Before you invest yourself, you know, after all this is, when we tatparata means investing yourself into a given pursuit. And so then it is necessary to settle all these things in your own mind as to what should I meditate upon. Swami, when I meditate upon Rama, what should I, so Kabir would say, Rama only means Ramante Yogino Yasmin, Rama only means Nirguna. And Tulsidasji would say, no, Rama means Dasharathi, Dasharatha Putra. He is Murugan, all right, but he is Saguna as well. But then your stories don't make any sense at all. This Ramayana says that, red Ramayana says something else. What is all these inconsistencies? Now if there are inconsistencies, then people will not have Shraddha in there, and therefore the inconsistencies must be resolved. Therefore all these discussions are there to resolve inconsistencies. So Tulsidasji will say, No, all these Ramayanas are right. How can they be right? Because Kalpa Bhedaha. After all, there are countless Kalpas going on, cycles. In every cycle, Rama takes incarnation. And therefore, in different cycles, his leelas are different. And therefore, all of them are okay. See, this is the heart of a devotee. Because for him it is important when he thinks of Rama. For the other fellow, it is not important, chalta hai, Rama was, I don't believe, I don't care whether Rama was born or not, you may say. And it may be alright for the way you approach, but then, for the one who wants to meditate on Rama, for him or her it is important to know. So what form, what ayudha, what anam, everything is important. All of them form part of his meditations. And so, what is essential, what is not essential, what is primary, what is secondary, what is meant for promotion, what is meant to be told as a fact. All of these things are so necessary for us to ascertain. And we must say that most of the misunderstandings among people arise on account of inability to grasp these things. As to what the other person, because always these problems are, you told me this the other day, I did not tell you, every day this goes on. I did not mean that, then ultimately this person will say, I said it all right, but I did not. So you are lying, not necessarily. You may say a thing, but mean something else, because that occasion required that to be said in that manner. And therefore, you must see the purvapara sambandha, you must see the prakaranam. What is the prakaranam? What's the context? What's the vidhi? What's the primary subject matter? All of these become so important in making, in delivering communication and in understanding communication. So it is not for no reason that these discussions are brought up. For those who want to perform the meditation here, for them it is necessary to settle all these accounts and all these details. Otherwise, for us it's all right, we study and go through. And with the satisfaction that we study, Swami, kona avi upasana karai, that's okay. But whether you do this upasana or not, I mean, in fact, even when we are studying, some part of upasana takes place anyway. And at the same time, this discussion gives us a much greater clarity. And when we understand our own mind, then we understand our own self. So therefore, this is clarity about our own self, how we think, and how a lot of misunderstanding may have been arisen in ourselves, or how we create misunderstanding elsewhere also. All of that we may be able to perhaps understand when we get an insight in the processes of how our mind works. But this is the base, how we are. I mean, what we are it comes from all this. So when we find ourselves different from others, like different from Westerners and whatnot, you wonder, why are we like this and why are we like that? Then, what makes us what we are? All of this makes us what we are. Therefore also, that's why Mimamsa etc. is so necessary to understand, that we may not know the technicalities and it may not even matter. But the spirit, when you understand, then you know how the scriptures communicated and how even today also part of it may be there in our own personality, or how it is so beautiful to, you know, how you can communicate in a certain way. All of this also are the side benefits, you know, that we gain as a result of this study. Okay, we will continue tomorrow. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Bhashya Kritau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah. Ishvaro Guru Ratmedi Murti Veda Vibhagine Vyomavat Vyapta Dehaya Lakshinamurtaye Namah. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namah. Harihi Om. Aha Prajapatyah Devascha Asurascha Tani Yasa Eva Devah Jayata Asuraha Sa Eshu Lokeshvas Pardhanta Deh Deva Uchuhu. Anta Asuran Yajna Udgi Senataya Medhi. In the discussion, Guru established that this section is meant for the Prana Upasana and not for anything else. It is not meant for enjoying the japa, asatoma sadhana, it's for dhyaroha japa. That is not the primary top subject matter of the section. Nor it is a section which enjoins the udgita, the chanting of the udgita. And because the several reasons were given, number one, this is the prakaranam or this is the discussion pertaining to upasana. Because one who has done the upasana is the one who performs the japa, and therefore also that which is nityam also always must be primary and anitya must be secondary, sheshi and shesha. Also, the result of the prana upasana is said to be attainment of the state of Hiranyagarbha. So that is the primary result, and therefore prana must be the upasya vishaya. It must be properly the object of meditation. Also it was said that when these pranas, such as this organ of speech, etc., when they performed the meditation upon this mukhya prana, then they were able to become free from their mukti or the sin and were able to attain the original state of devata, meaning they all became shining. All of them retained their luster. Thus the organ of speech became fire and the eyes became the sun and so forth. And thus all these organs, which were also called prana, all of them retained or regained their original status. That also shows that the upasya vishaya or the object of meditation is prana. In this it is said that it is shown here how the main topic here is the meditation upon the prana. Now very beautiful points are brought up for upasana here. Now on the page 76, Anandagiri says in the second paragraph, Uptanyayana Pranupastim Upetya Prana Devatam Shuddhyadi Gunavatim Akshipade. Uptanyayana, by the reasons that we just stated, Pranupastim Upetya, having ascertained that this is a section before the upasana or meditation upon the prana. Now upon which prana do you meditate? Shuddhyadi Gunavatim Akshipade. What are the attributes or the characteristics or qualities of this prana? That prana is possessed of such qualities as being pure. So akshapade, there is a question and now who questions that no, prana is not possessed of such qualities. All this akshapa or the negation or the questioning is done purely on the technical basis of mimamsa, in the sense that how to understand the statements. Because sometimes there is not consistency in the statement. When we say there is no consistency, there are different ways of interpreting a given statement. Sometimes we use one rule to understand a statement, and sometimes we say, no, that is not what is meant, something else is meant. Sometimes a statement may be called arthavada, meaning it is a praise for something in order to enjoin something else. And sometimes it is meant to be praised. So sometimes you don't know when someone is praising something, whether that person really deserves that praise, or is it true about that person, or because that person is to be projected in a certain way so that he should get a job, and whatever it is, so you want to project him. Thus, is prana projected as possessed of these qualities so that people will meditate upon it, or does he really possess those qualities? They do to meditate upon prana, all right. But does prana really possess those qualities, and thus do we meditate upon prana as possessed of the qualities or something else? So that is the question. So now that with prana upasana it is ascertained that the upasana upon the prana is to be performed, next question to be settled is, what should be meditated upon? Prana possessed of which attribute should be meditated upon is the next question. And in order to settle that, akshepa, first there is a question and then it is resolved. Bhavatu says that the Bhashya, Bhavatu nama pranasya upasanam.
ब्रह्मतो विशुद्ध्यादिगुणवत्ता इति
भवतु नाम प्राणस्य उपासनम्. ऑल राइट, वी एक्सेप्ट दैट आफ्टर दैट डिस्कशन वी एक्सेप्ट लेट बी दैट दिस एक्शन इज मेंट फॉर एंजॉयिंग उपासना और मेडिटेशन ऑन द प्राण. ऑल राइट, मुझे विशुद्ध्यादिगुणवत्ता. But we find it hard to accept that the prana is really possessed of these attributes such as viśuddhyatva, meaning viśuddhyatva meaning pure, etc. So we don't think that that is really what is meant literally about the prana.
This footnote number 7, nato ityadi shuddhyadi or viśuddhyadi gunavadi prana devadanasti pramana abhava.
Pura Pakshi means this. We say that prana really does not, this devata called prana, mukhya prana, does not possess this qualities of viśuddhatvam, etc. Pramana bhāt, because there is no pramana or a valid statement to say that.
Upāsti vidiparatvena śrudhe ukta devatāyā ukta devatāyām atātpariyāvityardha.
Upāsti vidiparatvena. See, this section is meant for upāsana. The point is that when you say something, then there is a mukhya tatparya, meaning there is a primary purport of what you say, and that should be the purport. You should not convey too many things by one statement. Therefore, the tatparya of one statement should be a tatparya's purport. One statement should not mean or should not seek to convey more than one thing, otherwise there will be confusion, and we cannot determine what is the primary message conveyed by the statement, and therefore, this statement cannot be said to be pramana. If our eyes tell us more than one thing about a given object, that it is yellow color as well as red color, suppose, then we don't know which is the color to take. So eyes should only mean one thing, that's all. One color, and not more than one. Suppose it is possessed of more than one color from different standpoints, perhaps it can do, but from a given standpoint, one thing alone. Similarly also, words of Vishuddhi being pramana, every vakya should only convey one meaning, and not more than one meaning, otherwise we do not know what is the meaning we should take. Similarly also, if this section enjoins upasana upon the prana, then that should be the main purpose. And not also to say that the prana is possessed of this quality, because there will be two messages. That you will not understand that this passage says that the prana is possessed of all the viśuddha guna, etc. Plus the passage says that one should meditate upon the prana, meaning that two kinds of things are given, that is, therefore, when you say that these statements or passages are meant for enjoining upasana upon the prana, then it is pramana or the valid means with reference to that and not with reference to any other detail. So therefore, it is pramana abhavat. Upasti vidiparatvena śrudhe. So these śrudhi passages are committed to or devoted to enjoining the upasana vidhi or the vidhi of meditation. Devatayam atatpariyat. Therefore, these passages do not have a tatpariya or purport really in describing the devata. Their attention is there. See, whenever you are committed to doing something, other things become all secondary. Primary thing is, for example, the cooking, that's primary thing. And then, when you are serving, the primary thing is feeding. Place, you know, food in a certain way, in a certain order and stuff like that, all that is secondary. Primary thing is feeding, appeasing hunger. In what order you eat, in what manner it is presented, you may do it by the way. But that is not where the tatparya is. Tatparya is, in so understand what is tatparya's purport is in feeding. Then when someone presents it, the food in a different order, all places in the dish in a certain different way, it does not matter because there is not the tatparya. So suppose when you want to feed somebody, you need not necessarily repeat every detail that somebody else did. What is important is that you should feed the person. What message should you get from what someone else does or conveys to you? And here also therefore, the Upanishad's tatparya or what Upanishad is committed to is in revealing that there is prana upasana we perform. So therefore other details that are given are not to be taken as equally important or not to be taken to be, you know, seriously for the simple reason that is not where the tatparya is. So therefore we should understand that we should be committed to one thing at a time. Otherwise people get mixed messages, you know, these are politicians, when they make statements, then people get mixed messages, and that's the whole idea also, to confuse others. So you give messages in such a way that people may draw different conclusions. But not when you want that your words should convey something. When your words are pramana, there should not be mixed messages. So all these passages meant for telling us the glory of the Pranadevata, or all these passages meant to tell us that we should perform upasana upon the Pranadevata. Guru Pakshi says that these passages are meant for enjoining the upasana upon the prana, and not upon, they are not committed to describing the glory of the prana. Therefore, the glory of the prana that we find, it doesn't have a primary meaning, it is only by the way. It's by the way that you brought the food in a certain order, or by the way that you placed it in your dish in a certain way, but that is not to be necessarily followed. Therefore, these passages are pramana for vidhi or the enjoyment of upasana of the prana. Therefore, they should not be taken as pramana or the valid means for the glories of the prana. And therefore, the glories of the prana described in these passages are not to be taken in a primary sense. And therefore, that we say that prana doesn't possess its glories, that the glories of prana are described by the way. Because these passages are pramanam for the upasana of vidhi, and therefore not pramanam for anything else.
This is the,
now you have to show, very technical but very beautiful. Why beautiful? Because you find this in our day to day thing, you know. And so how Bhashyakara handles this? First a casual answer is given. Says Anandaji, yatha pranasya upasthahi shastra dushtatvadishta tatha asya guna sambandha shrutatvadishtavya upastha upasthese gunavadi prane pramanikatva praptahe avisheshadhi siddhanti brute. Yatha pranasya upasthahi shastra dushtatvadishta. So just because shastra says that the prana should be meditated upon, and therefore you take it as the fact, or you take it as a valid means, valid statement. Tatha asya guna sambandha shrutatvade ishtavya. So also this passage describes the glories of the prana, and therefore since the Shruti describes it, therefore you should take it in a primary sense also. Upastav upasyeche gunavadi prane pramanikatva praptehe. So this passage has pramanikatvam or validity with reference to the upasana. So upasthi meaning with reference to the meditation, as well as upasthi with reference to the object of meditation. Upastho meaning in upasana, upasthyecha meaning with reference to the object of meditation. In both of these are described in the passages, and therefore these passages of Shruti are valid with reference to both the subject matters. Pramanikatva praptehe avisheshat is siddhanti brute. That's what the siddhanti says. Brute, footnote number 5. Brute iti devata adhikaranyayena parihati tyardaha. Now, this Bhashyakara here replies on the basis of what has been settled in Brahma Sutras. So, all these points have been brought up for discussion in Brahma Sutra, and there certain conclusions have been arrived at. So devata adhikaranam nyayena. Nyaya means that rule or the reasoning which has been presented in the Brahma Sutra in a topic called devata adhikarana, whether devata have adhikara in Brahma Vidya or not. This is a discussion there. Manushyas have, but have devata's adhikara, are devata's qualified for Brahma Vidya or not? Somebody says, no, they are not qualified for Brahma Vidya. Only human beings are qualified. And then one line of argument is that devatas are what? They are not tangible entities, they are intangible entities. Then the argument there is that no, devatas are also persons, possessing forms and attributes, etc. So they also have a personality, and there is also a possibility in them that Viveka Vairagya qualifications can be developed in them also, because they are also gaining different enjoyments or pleasures, and they will also at some point in time see the limitation of pleasures. So there will be vairagya in them, and therefore there will be jignyasa in them for the Brahma Vidya. So devatas also are qualified for Brahma Vidya. This is the idea. For whatever reason, this is the idea. You know, there.
Why should we be interested in devatas?
But they are interested because they are all mentioned in the Shastra, you know. Similarly concerned that I am doing all these rituals here and suppose I am wind up in heaven, then am I deprived of Brahma Vidya? Don't worry. There also you can get the qualification and therefore. If you go to Brahma Loka, don't worry. There also you can be qualified and you will be liberated. Meaning that the qualification is primarily there only in the Manushya Loka, but then it can also be there in other Lokas and therefore, if there is a real desire for that Brahma Vidya, then Prapya Punya Kritan Loka Anusitva Shaswati Samaha. Therefore, living in the Brahma, in the Savarga Loka, etc., or Pitru Loka for a great length of time, again you will be back on this pursuit. And not that your punya will be exhausted only in sense pleasures, etc. So whatever. So this is the adhikarana. So the kind of discussion that is pursued in that adhikarana is what is brought to my mind here in order to, that same idea is applied here in order to clear this point. Footnote number 5 continues. Mantra arthavada itihasa purana loka prasiddhyindhya vigrahadi panchaka visishta devata drushte na pratyakhyanam sambhavade. Mantra. So, the Vedas have all these Vedas have mantra. Arthavada, stuti, itihasa, describing what happened. Purana, then what is in the Vedas is also reflected in the Puranas. And loka prasiddhi, that the people also talk about it. So they say, Vajrahastha Purandaraha. These are mantras. Purandaraha means Indra is Vajrahastha, has Vajra in his hands. So Arodit. Then this Rudra or Agni cried, you know, and that is called Arthavada. This is also what we find in the Vedas. And we discuss in Brahma Sutra how this Rudanam. You know, that is Agni wept because silver was given in Dakshina, so silver should not be given in Dakshina. Who has given silver in Dakshina, that Yajamana will leap and stuff like that. So idea is to enjoy the Dakshina, I guess, of gold or whatever. Ishtan bhogan hyo deva dastyante yajna havitaha. So this is what the Shruti or Itihasa. So Mahabharata and other Itihasa also tell us that if you please the devatas, then devatas also will please you. So in that devata adhikarana, vajrahastha purandaraha, Indra is possessed of vajra. So Vedas describe that there is an entity called Indra, possessed of certain characteristics and possessed of certain form, etc., as holding vajra or thunderbolts. Saha arodit, that fire wept, means Agni can weep also, so he is a personality. Then, Ishtan Bhogan Yo Devaha Dasyante Yajna Bhavitaha. Then when you please the devatas, the devatas also will respond in the kind. So that devatas are person who can be pleased. Then when you offer the oblations here, the devatas receive the oblations. And therefore, they also give the karmaphala. So karmaphala dātrutvam is there in the devatas. And that they also partake in the havish or the oblation that you make. It is also there. Then lokevi yamam dandahastam lakhande indram vajahastame loka prasiddhi. People also say, I saw that Yamaraja, you know, he was possessed. I dreamt Swami and I saw this. I mean, people also say, I saw Yamaraja as possessed of that danda, you know, yamadanda. I had darshan of Indra where he was possessed of the thunderbolt. So loka prasiddhi, people have all kinds of visions. These days it was said, there was a big report in Time magazine that these days now Jesus Christ is going out of fashion. And Mary is really gaining the ground in the whole universe, you know, as far as the Ishta Devata. Because she is appearing in so many places in the world before the devotees. And then people are worshipping Mary. Jesus Christ, so theek hai, but people have other needs. Christ is worshipped for moksha, etc. But people have needs of artha kama, etc. And then Mary is a mother. And that is how she has now become more prominent an object of worship in Christianity. That is how when they describe Mary, then it gives validity to the idea that Mary as a person was possessed of certain attributes, etc. And then now confirmation. So mantra, arthavada, itihasa, purana, then all this loka prasiddhi, these are the five means by which something can be ascertained. Similarly, from this five means we learn that the devatas are possessed of certain characteristics and therefore devatas are persons, means individuals, possessed of certain characteristics.
And therefore, they have the qualification for Brahma Vidya. This is a trend of discussion there, by the way. And that is what is referred to. Mantra, Arthavala, Itihas, Purana, Loka, Prasiddhibhya, Vigrahadi, Panchaka, Vishishta, Devata, Dushte. Then you must meditate upon Devatas as possess certain characteristics. Vigrahadi, Panchakam. Vigraha means a form. That same footnote says that Vigrahadi, Panchakam, Cha Uktam. Vigraho, Havisham, Bhogaha, Aishwaryam, Cha Prasannada. Kalapadana Mityeda Panchakam Vigrahadikam. The Devatas are possessed of these five things. Vigraha, that they have a Vigraha, means a form. Vajrahasta Purandaraha. All India is supposed is described having thousand eyes and things like that. And therefore, that they have a Vigraha, they have a form. Harisham Bhogaha. That when you offer the oblations here, then they also partake in that oblations. That is important, you know, you keep on throwing things in the fire, and suppose devatas don't receive it, then what? No, havisham bhoga, that they do the bhoga, meaning that they actually enjoy, or they actually eat or consume that havish of the oblations given by us in the fire. Aishwaryancha, that they are aishwarya, they are capability of the power. Otherwise, what's the use of worshipping you when you are powerless? So, why should you worship them? You worship only those who are powerful, because they can protect you, or they can give you the phala, etc. So devatas are possessed by Aishwarya. Prasannada, then they can be pleased. Then you can gain their favor. Otherwise, suppose, regardless of what you do, suppose they don't respond at all, then no point. So prasannada. And therefore, that devata also can become prasanna. And therefore, you can do what is required for a given devata to win their favor. Phala pradhanam, and then they do also the phala or the karma phala. Meaning, if you worship a certain devata for a certain thing, if it is in the domain of that devata, then that devata will give you that phala. You know? So this is how, not every devata can give everything. So, Vasindavan is kind of a funny thing, you know, that this man worshipped Shitala Devi, I guess, you know. And ultimately, that devi appeared before him. Then he says, what do you want? What can I give you? He says, well, please give me one horse. He says, stupid, if I could give you a horse, why should I ride on a donkey? So every devata cannot give you anything. They can give you what is in that domain. But anyway, you should know that. You should know what devata can give you what, and what upasana should be performed, what havish they eat, all of this should be known, and how they look and everything, how to meditate upon them, and then you will enter them. The idea is, all of these about devata is well known in Mantra, Aswada, Itihasa, Purana, and Loka Prasiddhi. In this file, these things are devatas are well known, and therefore devatas are individual entities, and therefore they have adhikara in Brahma Vidya. So this is what is said there. Therefore it is said, Vigrahadi Panchaka Vishishta Devata Drashte, Drashti means Upasana. Then Upasana meditation about the devatas possessed of this Vigrahadi Panchakam, possessed of a form, and possessed of the prasannada, havi bhakshanam, etc. So that devatas are possessed of this. Then and therefore, when the scriptures enjoin meditation upon devatas as possessed of these attributes, then don't think that it is wrong. Na pratyakhyanam yodhi. Then you can reject it or dismiss it because devatas are there. Vishuddhyadi shrutehe pranupasana vidyarthavadatvevi samvada visamvadayoho abhave dvārārthe mānatva virodhādita abhiprāya. Similarly here also, that prāṇāyama is possessed of certain glories or certain, you know, so that is what is being described. The glories of prāṇā are described here. Therefore, we should not dismiss that, alright, even though the primary message, the primary purpose of this passage is to enjoy upāsana upon the prāṇā, but this passage also describes the glories of prāṇā, and those glories, even though not the primary message, are nevertheless valid message. Secondary thing can also be right, meaning that when we talk about certain things, or when we don't tell stories, it's not that every time a story is an imagination. Sometimes the story can be true also. So with reference to an actual event, they think can be illustrated. So to illustrate that point is the primary purpose of the speaker, but by the way, he also tells you certain things. He will give you benefit of the experiences. And people then say, look at this one, always boasting about it. That is not the idea, you know. Sometimes, you know, some Mahatmas have the habit.
of what they experience in Himalayas and what they came across, and sometimes they get so engrossed in that that what they are trying to say becomes even lost, and that also happens. But very often the points are illustrated with reference to actual experiences, so that the listeners not only get the message, but they also get the benefit of certain experiences, and you know, in that way, some other general knowledge also is given. And then every Mahatma always has certain areas, you know, and then when it comes to that, they always pass on their knowledge or whatever it is, you know. Remember, it is possible that, remember the primary purpose of a speech is to convey a certain point. By the way, the manner in which it is conveyed or the illustration, etc., which are used for the purpose of conveying the message, also may be right. Those illustrations become dwara. They become the very gate or become the means. Dwara means sadhanam. They become the means for conveying a point. And then when I say akhandanandi, you are saying, that is what he was really saying. Oh, Swami, you are all making of the story. Not all the time. Remember, sometimes we may be really telling the thing as it happened. Why should we say this? In order to perhaps say something about a Mahatma also and whatever. So primary point is to tell about the limitations of the Buddha. But by the way, you may also say how other Mahatmas are and you know how they communicate, etc. So that is how a certain overall tradition also is communicated in by the way. So that is called dwara. Dwara means the means. So the story that you use for conveying a point also can be right if it is not contradicted otherwise. Suppose I said yesterday Akhandanandji told me this, then it is wrong because he passed away say 3 years ago, then he could not have told you, therefore he must be making the story and the purpose must be something else. Or you already know something, you know, then also there is nothing to be conveyed because you already know something. And therefore, yesterday, you know, this thing happened in the class and we lost the light, etc. and so forth. Suppose the reference to that something is said, then you already know it, and therefore also nothing is to be conveyed because it is already well known. But when I tell you something about the Eiffel Tower or whatever, let us say, for which you haven't seen it, therefore, nor you cannot contradict it, nor can you confirm it. Pratyaksha is not there, meaning you have not seen it, nor have you heard anything again otherwise. If somebody says Eiffel Tower is 15,000 feet, and if I say it is 1,000 feet, then you will wonder, then there is a contradiction, then perhaps you may not be able to take my statement on any face value. But when I say that Eiffel Tower is 360 meters, so when I give an exact number. Now that is not the point. The point is something else. But in that description, I also describe this, then there is nothing that can contradict this because you have not seen it, so pratyaksha pramana does not contradict. Or from whatever else you heard, then also there is no contradiction. Then you will also accept that Eiffel Tower is 360 meters. So that is conveyed by the way. So that becomes a dwara or the means for conveying something else, but then that detail also is right. And then well, now, what I say has conveyed two things. One is primarily conveyed how wonderful Paris or wonderful France is. And by the way, it also says that this museum called Louvre has the famous painting of Mona Lisa. Then all that's by the way information. The idea is how wonderful that place is. So the purpose is to describe the wondrousness of that place, and by the way certain details, and those details become the dwara or the means to convey the wonderfulness of that place. So primary message is wonderfulness, at the same time those other secondary things also are right, or they can also be taken to be correct because there is no contradiction otherwise. So this was the thing. That even though the primary message of the Vedas is not perhaps to describe, to say that the devatas are such and such, by the way they seem to describe so many things, and therefore we have to tell them sometimes primarily, sometimes by the way. Here also, Vishuddhyadi Shrutehe Pranopasana Vihi Arthavadatvehi. Even though the glories that are described the prana are the arthavada, meaning they are only in order to enhance, you know, the commitment to upasana. Sometimes to encourage someone to do, to inspire someone to do, or to enhance the certain value. And here therefore also the description of the glories of the prana are, they are not the primary, the arthavada, they are the stuti or the eulogy of the prana in order to emphasize in order to enjoy the upasana. So that arthavada, no doubt, but still.
Samvada visamvada yoho abhave.
Samvada means pratyaksha, the confirmation. You learn from devatas and therefore there is, you don't know that you don't need otherwise. Since you have not seen the devata, there is no need for you to dismiss it.
Visamvada yoho.
Or you will know the devatas in a different way, then also you will dismiss. So since there is no reason to dismiss, therefore, even though it is arthavada, it is still taken to be on its face value. Therefore, the glorious pranas described in these sections, even though they are of the nature of arthavada, they are the eulogy or the stuti of the prana, they are nevertheless correct in detail because there is no reason for us to dismiss them.
Dvarārthe manatva avirodhāt.
So, pramāṇyam the passage primarily is in terms of the upāsana vidhi, and dvarārthe in a secondary way, this passage has also become pramāṇa for describing the glories of the prāṇa.
So this is the trend of argument that is going to be pursued by Bhāṣyakāra. So that is what the Tīkākāra see as Bhāṣyakāra pursuing, you know. And so it is Siddhānti Grūte. This is what the Siddhānti says. Namuti. Says Bhāṣyakāra. Namuti-yāśrutatvā.
That person says that, well, prana is not possessed of this glory of such as purity, etc. Bhāṣyakāra first says, nanu syāśrutatvāt. So Śruti says that, therefore it should be accepted in its face value, that the prana is indeed possessed of this glory.
Then Ānandamiri says, prāṇasya upāśyatvevi viśuddhyādi-guṇavādasya stutyartatvena arthavādatva-sambhavāt tethokta devatāsyāt iti pūruvāni āha.
Prāṇasya upāśyatvevi, yes. We accept the prana is the deity to be meditated upon, and that is definitely conveyed through this passage.
Viśuddhyādi-guṇavādasya stutyartatvena.
But then various glories such as purity, etc., which are described with reference to prana, they are really meant for just praising the prana, and therefore they are merely arthavada, and arthavada is there which does not have swarthe tatparyam. Arthavada does not have purport in itself, is always meant for communicating something else. So arthavada serves the purpose of vidhi. So if these statements are merely arthavada, then generally speaking, arthavada is meant to serve the purpose of the vidhi, namely prana upasana. Therefore, these statements being classified as arthavada do not have the validity in themselves, and therefore they don't want to be taken literally. This is Puru Paksha.
Arthavadatta sambhavat yathokta devatasya.
Yathokta means viśuddhyādi guṇavati. If the devata possessed of these attributes is there is no, you don't accept that. There is prana all right. That there is upasana of prana all right. But that prana is possessed of these glories, etc. That is not what we should learn from these, or that is not what we should understand as the purport of this passage.
It is Puruvādhyāha. This is what the Puru Paksha says. Mutyādhyāha.
Says Bhāṣya.
Nasyād upāsyatve sutya sattva upapatte. Nasyād, says Puru Paksha, no.
Even though Śruti describes the glory of the prana, still the Śruti does not have purport in describing those glories, or those statements are not to be taken literally.
Why? Upāsyatve sutya sattva upapatte.
See, the primary purport is upasana of the prana, therefore this description is to be taken as stuti or eulogy of the prana, and therefore arthavada, and therefore they are not to be taken literally. We should know what should be taken literally and what is not to be taken literally. The things that are not to be taken literally when you do, there is a lot of problems, confusion. And what is to be taken literally when you don't, then also there is a problem. So yogi should be also. What is to be taken literally and what not? So Puru Paksha says that the description of prana's glory are not to be taken literally because that is a style that is arthavada, whereas that the Śruti enjoins upasana, that should be taken literally.
Says Anandamayi, Viśuddhyādi-guṇavatāt asya arthavādatvevi
गुणवादस्य अर्थवादत्वे भी न अभूतार्थवादत्वं भी परिहरते न अभूतार्थवादत्वं इन भूतार्थवादत्वं विशुद्ध्यादि गुणवादस्य अर्थवादत्वे भी यस वी एक्सेप्ट दैट दिस डिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ विशुद्धत्व ऑफ द प्योरिटी ऑफ प्राण इज अर्थवाद मीनिंग इज फॉर द स्तुति ऑफ द प्राण देन न अभूतार्थवादत्वं It is not abhutarthavada meaning, it is not artha. Abhutarthavada means arthavada in keeping with bhuta or what has happened. So description in keeping with what has happened is called bhutarthavada. Description not in keeping with what has happened is called abhutarthavada. So this description of prana should be taken as that in keeping with how prana is or it should be taken to be not in keeping with the way prana is. Guru Pakshi says, this description of prana is not in keeping with the way prana really is. Then the Siddhanta says, no, the description is in keeping with the way the prana really is. Abhutasavadatam. Says Kutranavasana Abhuta Ityari, Avidyamana Samodhagatam Ityarvaha. So sometimes the statements tell us something which actually is not the fact, but still you say it for some other purpose. Are the statements of that category? The Siddhanta says, no, these statements are of the category that what they say also is true. What prana? So, maybe Pariharati, say Vashagana. Avipariita sapratipatte Shreya prapti upapatte Lokavata Yohi अविपरीतम् अर्थम् प्रतिपद्यते लोके सह इष्टं प्राप्नोति इष्टाद्वा निवर्तते न विपरीतात् प्रतिपद्या अविपरीतार्थ प्रतिपत्ते श्रेय प्राप्ति उपपत्ते लोकवत लोकवत जस्ट एज इन द वर्ल्ड इन अवर कॉमन एक्सपीरियंस श्रेय प्राप्ति अवर वेल बीइंग यू नो इज डन इज सर्व द श्रेय प्राप्ति व्हाट इज डिजायरेबल हैपेंस व्हेन अविपरीतार्थ प्रतिपत्ते व्हेन देयर इज प्रतिपत्ति और अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ अविपरीतार्थ विपरीतार्थ मीन्स कॉन्ट्रेरी मीनिंग Avaparitartha means non-contrary meaning yathartha. So still instead of using the word yathartha, Vashyakara is using avaparitartha because the problem is that the Purvapakshi says that is avaparitartha. So Vashyakara says avaparitartha means yathartha. Avaparitartha pratipattehe meaning only when there is an understanding of the meaning as it is actually there, Shreya prapti upapattehe, then alone there is Shreya prapti, then alone there is a prapti of the attainment of Shreya. Attainment of something that is desirable. So something desirable or something good is attained by a person, only the person has an understanding of the true meaning and nobody is good or well-being happens by understanding something wrongly. Yohi avaparitam artham pratipadyate loke avaparitam yathabhutam. So only when a person understands the thing as it is, Sahishtam prapnoti, then alone we know that he will be able to. So whenever you learn something that is true there, then alone there is truth in life, I mean then alone you will be able to know how to deal with the thing. Suppose you understand something wrongly. What is there in a rope and you take it to a snake and the way you respond to it is really wrong. Then there is bhaya kampari, all kinds of things will be there because you have understood a thing to be other than what it is. And when you know the rope as rope or snake as snake, then your response will be proper. See, if there is a snake and you think it is rope, then also there is also going to be calamity. And if there is a rope and you take it to the snake, then also it is bad. So either way, when avaparitartha is there, meaning when a thing is taken to be other than what it is, then there is always a loss or there is always, you know, a person, you know, it comes to some difficulty. On the other hand, when you understand things as they are, then definitely you always come to a good lot. So share market trend, if you know it as it is, good. Business trends, if you know as they are, good. A person's nature, if you understand as it is, good. Otherwise, all kinds of problems, you know. Remember, all of our problems are because of avipiritartha pratipattihi. All the problems can be traced to misunderstandings. Misunderstanding always leads to problems and suffering, and proper understanding always brings about the good, if not in the short run, in the long run. So Vashyakara says that when the Shruti says this, Shruti cannot tell you something which is not yathartha. Here the Shruti is telling you something that is yathartha. Yohi avipariitam artham pratipadyate loke saha ishtam praapnoti. So when someone understands a thing for what it is, then alone ishtam praapnoti. Then alone he attains something that is good. Anishtadvan yatad, or he is saved from anishta. There is a snake and you know it is a snake. Okay, then you are at least saved from anishta or some calamity that may happen. Either way it's okay. Viparitartha pratipatya. But then when you understand things wrongly, then either you will come to a bad lot, anishta will happen to you, or you will be deprived of ishta. Either you will lose what you should have gained, or you will gain what you should not have gained, and something definitely will happen when things are understood wrongly. And therefore, when the right understanding leads to the welfare of a person, and the wrong understanding generally brings about some kind of pain or suffering for the person. So Vashyakara continues, Tatha ihape shrauta shabda janita satpratipattau shreya praptihi upapanna navibaryaye. Tatha ihape, similarly here also. Ihape means in the Vedas also, or in the Upanishad that we are talking about. Shrauta shabda janita artha pratipattau. Shrauta shabda, that is the shabda that is propounded by the Shruti, or what the Shruti presents. Janita artha, the artha or the meaning that is generated as a result of what the Shruti says, the words that the Shruti uses. Pratipattau, if you understand them as they are meant. Here Vashyakara only means that we should understand the Shruti in a manner in which it is meant. If Shruti means it only as a stuti, we should understand it as such. If Shruti means that it should be taken literally, we should understand it as such. If Shruti says that it means it to be really, we should know it as such. If Shruti means that it is nisheda, we should know it as such. That's all. Meaning we should understand the Shruti for what, as it intends to communicate. Shrauta shabdot, no, shrauta shabda janita artha pratipattau. Only then the pratipatti or the knowledge of the meaning of the words of the Shruti as they are sought to be conveyed, then alone shreya praptihi upapanna, then alone our well-being or welfare will be served, viparyaye. And if you understand the Shruti passages in a way different from what they seek to convey, then their shreya prapti or our well-being will not take place. We will either deprive from something good, or we will land into something that is undesirable. Says Anandavi, Vishuddhyadigunavishishtaprana-drishtehe atra-phala-praptihi shruta nasa-jnanasya mithyatatve-yukta sammi-jnanayo-pumasa-praptihi samvat atah-stutihi-api-yathartha-eva-ityatah. Vishuddhyadigunavishishtaprana-drishtehe atra-phala-praptihi shruta. See, Anandavi says that phala-praptihi, the attainment of the phala, attainment of the result of the nature of the state of Hiranyagarbha, when you attain that result, only when you meditate upon the prana. And which prana? Prana is possessed of this glory, namely the purity, etc. So what these passages say is that not only should you meditate upon the prana, but you should meditate upon prana as possessed of these attributes. And then not you get, not only you meditate upon Narayana, but Narayana is what? Chaturbhuja, Shinka Chakra, Gada, Padmaha, etc. And then the description of devatas are also there, and you should meditate upon the devatas with those descriptions. So prana also is devata. And since there is a meditation upon the prana as devata, therefore the characteristics of the devata described in the Shruti also should be should be correctly understood, and when you meditate upon Prana Devata as possessed of those characteristics, then alone the ultimate result will come. Otherwise, you repeat Rama, 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 result will come. But when you know Rama is Dasharati, and when you know Rama is possessed of those qualities, you know.
Vaidehi Sahitam Surat Dhrumatale Haime Mahamandape.
So Rama's picture is described. How is sitting with Vaidehi? And how around, you know, there are Lakshmana and Bharata on the side, and how and Shatrughna and, you know, also there, Hanuman is also in the front. So the whole picture is given. And when you meditate in this manner, then the result will be much more significant than meditating on Rama as without, as not possessed of certain specific attributes. So, when Shruti here enjoins meditation not only upon the Prana Devata, but enjoins meditation upon Prana Devata as possessed of certain attributes such as Vishuddhatvam, and that is how. It is that meditation which leads to the results that are stated here, namely attainment of the state of Hiranyagarbha. Suppose you meditate upon the prana, and prana is not possessed of those qualities, and if you do that meditation, that cannot give you the proper results.
Samyajnanadeva umasat praptehe.
Only when there is a samyajnanam is there. Meaning when the knowledge is not contradicted, or knowledge is not false, and then you meditate, then alone it can give you umasat praptehe. Here, the attainment of a desired result will take place only when your meditation is right. Not only that you are meditating, but that your meditation also is proper. That you are meditating upon the Devata, which is what it is, in fact.
Ataha stutihi api yathasa eva ityartha.
And therefore we have to say that, since in these passages, the upasana on the Prana Devata is enjoined, therefore,